This lamp here can save you £120 a year compared to this one.
Well, welcome to the eFIXX Lighting Evaluation Test Centre. What you've got there, Gary, is a Son T lamp, the workhorse of Rawdon street lighting. You'll be familiar with them. It's that orange glow that you may or may not still have around your city or town that you live in. And we think we've got a great direct replacement for it. It's this new TrueForce Core LED road lamp from Phillips.
I'm always impressed how you can remember the names of the products. It's one thing I really struggle with, but as I look down here, where did you get this from?
Well, since it says road lamp on there, I thought I'd best invest in a fixture we can obviously show the performance. And I've been on a well-known online retail auction site and bought this one. It's amazing what you can buy on there.
It is amazing what you can buy on there. And what is amazing is the road trip that we took to Manchester. Because on the journey, we had a conversation about how difficult it's probably going to be to find these Son T lamps still out there. But when we got there, we were amazed.
Yeah, there's hundreds of installations out there. I mean, within a few hours, we found a car park outside a hotel, lighting up buildings. The tram network still has Son lamps or HID lamps in there that these also can replace. But also a well-known football club, Gary.
Well, one of the richest football clubs in the world, the Etihad Stadium, where we've spent millions and millions of pounds on players. As you turn and look at the car park, there's a fantastic opportunity to save energy and therefore money.
Yeah, and we think this is a great opportunity for electricians of all sizes and scale because there are so many of these out there. If you look hard in the installations you're looking at, you could probably find some of these there. And this is a quick win. And with energy prices where they are at the minute, we think this is a great proposition for customers.
You say quick win, so I'm expecting this to be a really simple process for me. So what I'm going to have to do then in order to put one of these LEDs in?
Okay, so it's a drop-in replacement. So it's a case of just unscrewing that existing Son T lamp and screwing this into place. And there we go. I've already bagged a significant energy saving. So in the case of this, this is a 100-watt lamp here. So it says on the box, 100-watt is the replacement for 100-watt. We can go down to 40 watts straight away.
Okay, so when we made that direct replacement, we actually registered 45 watts on the actual instrument itself, didn't we? So we went from 100 down to 45. I know straight away I'm saving money.
Yeah, we certainly are, but you'll notice that's slightly higher than suggested on the box itself.
Yes.
That's because we've got some control gear in there as well. Now, it is recommended in there to remove the capacitor that was in there originally. To remember to correct the power factor of the magnetic gear that you typically find in these. And it must be stressed at this stage, it's direct replacement for if you've got magnetic gear. If you've got electronic gear, you'd have to remove the gear and we'll come on to that. But it is recommended you remove that capacitor.
So why would I want to go to the trouble of removing that capacitor then?
Okay, so we get into the area of power factor. Some people call it VARs, volt amperes reactive, which is quite a difficult concept to grasp. For a lot of people, but if you took our voltage and current figures on there when we put this lamp in, it looks like this is taking 500 watts. It's not. The lamp is still taking 40 watts, but the system, because it's got an inductive control gear in there and it's been corrected by a capacitor, what we've actually done is take a system that was near unity power factor, but now we've forced it to be a leading power factor, which means we need a lot of current to drive the power to the lamp.
Okay, that could be a real problem then, couldn't it? With that huge current, we could find that once we've changed several of these in a circuit, we could actually blow the overcurrent protection device then, couldn't we?
Yeah, now take the numbers we've shown here with a little bit of pinch of salt because this fitting was originally designed for a 250-watt lamp, so we're probably amplifying the problem, but you would want to remove that capacitor to correct the power factor. So we do that, and you'll notice then on the meter, we've gone to about a 0.5 power factor, which again looks like the current is higher than it should be, but remember that is about the similar current level that had been used to drive the original lamp that was in the circuit, so it's not going to cause problems with the power supply.
However, so if I've gone to the trouble of taking out the capacitor, why don't I just take everything out and go direct to mains?
So we're just going to look at how we remove all of the control gear and convert the lamp so it's direct to mains. So first I'm just going to snip off these cable ties.
Okay, it looks more complicated than it is, but it is actually quite a simple process, isn't it?
Yeah, so we've got an igniter, we've just removed the capacitor anyway. So I've got two wires coming up from our lamp cap. It is an Edison screw lamp cap. So the last thing we want to do is take our line terminal to the large metal contact area that you can easily put your finger onto.
Okay, so once we've identified and stripped them back, keep them as long as we possibly can, we're identifying the neutral and line just so we get the Edison screw polarity correct. So you're popping out the conductors.
Right, so there's one.
Okay.
And then the other one routes across through to the...
Because it's black, everybody in their own mind saying, oh, that used to be neutral, that's what I'm thinking it is. Well, we've got another one that might have been white in the past.
Okay, I'm just going to snip that because I can't easily get into that screw.
Okay, so all right, so we've got these two now to work right. out.
So that's the two. I'm just going to strip out these two terminals here. Now you can see the line comes in and then immediately vanishes up to our photo cell and the NEMA socket on the top there. Bit of terminology for you.
Okay, and you can keep that photo cell in circuit?
Yeah, obviously you want to keep the photo cell. That's I say the most efficient lights are ones that aren't on.
Okay, so a little bit of rerouting here.
So this is all surplus to requirements.
Obviously a little bit of value in here as well, isn't it? If you are having to strip them out, I would suggest that choke or ballast, whatever you want to call it, it's worth keeping those, isn't it?
Yeah, got the scrapyard. Right, so we've now got... Just going to now bring in our continuity tester and see which one goes to the case.
Okay, so this one here.
Okay, right, so it doesn't look like it's the white wire. And it is the black wire. You were right, Gary.
Okay, so they've gone for black for neutral. So it's important now we get the, obviously it's a switching line through the photo cell, so we're going to bring in our neutral. You made the connection for that, so it just passes straight through the connector, yes?
Yeah, that's it. And then the line conductor, which is the white one. Obviously you would be just checking your wiring as well to make sure it's... But the red looks a little bit... I wouldn't say it's charring, just dust.
Okay, yeah. Well, we are doing it...
So the interesting thing, if you were working on this on a live streetlight install, you can isolate it by removing the whole gear tray, possibly. You might want to do that at the bottom of the column, not stuck up in the basket.
That makes logical sense. So we're hoping now, by getting rid of everything, that we're going to make another energy saving.
Yeah, so now let's just... lamp back in.
Obviously we're doing this under controlled conditions, so let me go with the lamp. Okay. Let's go there. We'll slide it back into position. And we're now direct to mains.
Direct to mains.
Okay, so it works. And now we see a massive improvement in the power factor, don't we? So we're almost at unity. And what current are we using, Gordon? Is that 0.1 or is that 0.1?
Yeah, 0.168 yeah. amps.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so our power factor is now 0.97, so nearly unity. And our wattage is below the rated wattage on the box, actually now down at 38, where if you remember, we started this up at 45, so I'd suggest... It is worth stripping out all of the control gear and going direct to mains, but you will need to do one more thing as part of that process. And obviously, once we've done this, we're now at a point of no return. You can't now go back and put a old sodium lamp in there.
Even if you could find one. So let's say, imagine we did find one. I'd be a bit concerned. I don't want that direct to mains.
Yeah, it won't work. So I'm just going to... This label does come in the box.
Okay.
And that advises you that you can't... there's no... It won't work with the original control gear.
It'll be the least of your problems, it not
so
working.
Just find a suitable space for that. I'd put that just down. There's a bit of room on the reflector there.
Okay, yeah. Just so got a label there. In place. We've clearly proved there we can save energy and therefore money. Is there any other salient benefits for installing them?
There certainly is, yeah. Unless you like living under orange streetlights, you can move obviously to a nice white light. So either warm or 4,000 degrees Kelvin cool white light. So that can lift the look and feel of an area.
You can, yeah.
And you also get instant light as well. So the minute we power this up, there's no warm-up time and restrike that you might get with the traditional lamp.
Yeah, there isn't. And I'm looking there and I'm looking at the actual diffuser in there. Is that another benefit?
Yeah, so because it's dimensionally similar and optically similar, you can reuse the optics that are designed as part of this streetlight. So you're not going to necessarily have to redesign the whole layout. You know, the most efficient light, obviously going for a brand new fixture with brand new optics, but that's quite complicated. You've got the cost of obviously a new fixture, plus you'd have to probably do a redesign to make sure the light distribution was the same. You don't have that with this lamp. It is just a drop-in optical replacement.
And the lamp's life is about 6 years, isn't it, when I looked at the box?
Well, you've done the maths there, Gary. So 25,000 hours, and if we assume, a street light's on for
half the time of the day because it's dark. So, 4,000 hours.
And 15,000 switching cycles. And you think when you've removed all the old gear, we are direct to that lamp. So we're going to be up at those numbers, aren't we?
Yeah, as I say, for 15,000 switching cycles, how long is that?
That's a long time. Yeah. As we're straying into the world of maths, I think we'll use the saying, as they do on The Apprentice, it's over to Claude with the numbers.
Well, Lord Gary, it's quite depressing, actually. Despite decades of energy-efficient performance, Team Sonti comes in at 100 watts for the lamp, but when you include gear losses, that is 115 watts per lamp. So if we extrapolate that over 4,000 hours, means to power one streetlight, we are using 460 kilowatt hours per year. Swap over to Team TrueForce Core LED road lamp, that obviously goes down to 40 watts because we've stripped out that gear. That saves an additional 20 kilowatt hours per year by doing that. So our 4,000 hours then comes in at 160 kilowatt hours per year. Now, rolling that forward into energy saving gives us 300 kilowatt hours per year of saving. Now, it depends on where you are in the world and what you're paying for your energy. That translates into money. And for us, we're fixed at 40 pence a kilowatt hour, and lots of parts of the world still laugh at us for paying that much. But for us, that equates to £120 a year. Now, we had a quick look online at this range, and we will leave a link in the description for the range because there's obviously different power levels and outputs available. But for the 40 watt version, we think that equates to about a 6 to 8 month return on investment for the cost of that lamp.
Now, they were interesting numbers, weren't they, Claude? And as I think about interesting, I look at the side of the packaging here and see its energy rating is C and not A or A+, which we traditionally associate with LED lamps. And if you want to know more about energy ratings and how they've changed, as well as this lamp here, check out the video over here.